In this video, we'll talk about how to study soils. This is a very important part of any investigation, and you need to know how to do it properly. I would like to start with St. Francis Dam failure that occurred in California in 1928 to show that site investigation is very important. This is the dam that was designed and built to hold water. 3 weeks after the dam was completed, there was a huge failure. So the dam collapsed, and this is the picture of a dam after it was collapsed. So what happened? After the failure, they did very thorough site investigation to find out the reason. And apparently this dam, or part of this dam, was built on ancient landslide. So in fact, that part of the slope was unstable because many years ago it failed as landslide. But because the previous site investigation didn't pick it up, so the dam was built on this potentially unstable slope. And when the dam was filled with water, there was some seepage through this part of the dam, because this soil wasn't as hard as the soil here on the left-hand side. So this part was ancient landslide that had undergone some movements over time, and it made the soil very, very soft and loose. So that was the major reason for this failure. To do site investigation, we need to follow a standard. And in Australia, it is a standard AS1726. It's a very important document that describes what type of site investigation needs to be conducted. Typically, for large projects, we spend about 1 or 2% of the project cost on site investigation. The first thing that we would like to do before we start a site investigation is to find the geological maps of the area that we would like to investigate. And this slide shows you an example of a geological map. You can see that this map has different colors. It has blue color, yellow color, and green color. So the color shows the age, and it also shows you the type of soil and rocks. Of course, when we first look at this map, we don't know what rocks or soils are there. That's why we need to look at the legend. This legend explains all the colors and gives us the age of each rock or soil formation. Another important thing of this geological map is cross-section. Geological map only shows rock or soil units which are right on the surface, but when we would try to dig something deeper, we would like to know what types of rocks or soils are there. That's why we need to look at cross-section. So each geological map should come with a cross-section, and in this case, it's line A dash. And the cross-section along this line is below. You can see that it shows different units here at different depths, and it also shows how they're placed in the space. These red lines shows geological faults, which also flag areas where rocks or soil is weak and loose. This is just an example of our geotechnical investigation that we conducted a few years ago on Gold Coast. This is a map of Springbrook area. And in this map, you will see types of rocks and soils. And another thing that you can see on this map is the location of landslides. So you see all these red dots. This is where landslides occurred. So this is a very useful map, because it tells us in what soil or rock formations landslides occurred, so that we can use this information to predict the future landslides and try to mitigate them. To obtain as much information as possible, we would like to take some samples from underground. To do that, we will use boreholes. We need to drill many boreholes, as many as we allowed. The only problem with boreholes is that they are very costly, and we need to think twice where we need to place them. Unfortunately, sometimes we don't have lots of funds to drill many boreholes so that we can get a very good understanding of geological conditions of the area. So we will drill as much as we can, and we will collect samples. This is just an example of a sample that we collect from borehole. This is another example where we take many samples of soil and rock. And after that, we'll examine that. We need to see if there are any cracks, if it's moist or not moist, and all this information goes to borehole logs. This is something that you would learn how to analyze in this course. And this is just a sample of borehole log. You will see that here on the left-hand side, depth of drilling, so where we collect samples. And another important part of this borehole log is the description. So description shows here. So what we have, either it's clay, sealed. In this case, we have clay sealed and silty clay. Then below we have silty clay again, and so on. Another important part that we would like to know from this borehole log is the amount of moisture in soil, which is shown here. As you will find out later, if soil has lots of water in it, it will become moist. And this is not very good property of soil. So in this case, you will see that at the top soil is moist. Then also if we go down, all the soil is moist. Moist soil is typically weaker than any dry soil or damp soil. Another important thing is consistency or density. It will show the consistency of the soil in the field. It can be firm, it can be loose, and there are different symbols that are given in the legend for each borehole. So just remember that borehole logs will give you very important information that you will need to know to draw a geological cross-section. Another thing that I didn't mention is results of SPT test. SPT test will give you some idea about the strength of soil at certain depths. So in this case, the depth is 1 meter. Then around 2 meters, there was another test. Excuse me, so there wasn't test here. So there was pocket penetrometer test here, not SPT. If we cannot drill boreholes because it's very expensive, we can do another test, which is called dynamic penetrometer test. And this is something that you would learn how to do in the first laboratory. The test is pretty simple. We can bring this equipment, which is called DCP, to any part where we'd like to investigate. It can be slope, or it can be area where we cannot bring a borehole drill. So the test is shown here in the picture. So this is DCP. We put it on the surface, and then we use hammer. This hammer to drive in to drive this DCP inside the soil, and we just measure the resistance of soil to the penetration of this cone, and we will plot these results. This is something again that you would learn how to do in the first laboratory. Pocket penetrometer test, it's another very useful test. It may not be very reliable. That's why we would like to do at least 3 measurements of each soil. The test is pretty simple. This is pocket penetrometer. We will press this part of the pocket penetrometer against the soil, and we'll just measure soil's resistance using the scale here. As I mentioned before, we'll need to do three tests and we'll get an average value. The good thing about this pocket penetrometer test is that it correlates with the unconfined compressive strength of soil. And these are the correlations for each type of soil. Typically, when we work on the site, we deal with general soil. So in this case, this is going to be the relationship. So it's 0.8 times the value of pocket penetrometer test. When we work with fields, the relationship will be slightly different. So the coefficient will increase to 1.15. This soil is mostly done for soft material, such as clay. Unfortunately, we cannot use it for sand. It just doesn't work. Also, we don't use it for rock samples. For rock samples, we have a similar type of equipment, which is called a Schmidt hammer. This slide shows you that it's also very important to know the level of groundwater. As you would learn later, the soil on the top, usually it's dry or it's damp. So it's not moist sometimes and it's not saturated. But when we drill borehole all the way down, at some point we will see that the soil is filled with water. So we would like to know the level of that water. And this is what we call groundwater level. We use this symbol to define this groundwater level. So what we assume is that the soil below this groundwater level is saturated. So there is water in the soil. Here on the top, above the groundwater level, there may be some water in it. So the soil can be moist here, but there is no groundwater level. You will see later that groundwater level will have a strong effect on the stresses in the soil, and this is why we need to know where the level is. To do that, we will use a piezometer. So we will drill a borehole, we'll drill a hole here, and we will install piezometer. Piezometer will measure the groundwater level, and if groundwater level fluctuates, because for example there is a heavy rainfall, in this case, groundwater level can even go up because more water will go in the soil. If we have a dry season, groundwater level can actually go down. So we would like to know where the groundwater level at the moment of investigation, because it will affect the strength of soil.